Hello and welcome to the Science on the Edge podcast. I'm Dr. Mark Darcy, and today's podcast is going to be a little bit different. This is going to be a little shorter than usual. A lot of my podcasts are quite long. I think my record is something like 2 hours and 45 minutes or thereabouts. Now, not everyone has a stamina for one of those podcasts and would possibly prefer something a little shorter. So what I'm going to be doing from now onwards is mixing my podcasts up a little bit. So some of them will be the usual format of 2 hours or so, 1 or 2 hours. Some will be the interviews that I've started to do recently, which can vary between an hour to an hour and a half. And some, like this, will be bite-sized episodes. So by bite-size, I mean short. Something that you can just quickly listen to and then get on with your life. So I aim to kind of make these no more than about 20 minutes or so, and some as short as 5 minutes. I don't know where this one is going to go in that just yet. I know what I'm going to talk about, but whether it's going to fit into 5, 10 or 20 minutes, I'm not so sure yet. You'll find out when I find out. I'll try not to go off at too many tangents, because that's when the podcast gets longer than usual. But before I start, I just want to say one thing. I actually record these podcasts at the moment just to sort of spread the message out there and get information and knowledge out to the world. I like teaching. I am a university lecturer, and this is just a way for me to reach a bigger audience. So really, I don't make a profit from these podcasts at all. I'm zero. I don't have any ads on my podcasts. My aim is to try not to place ads on my podcast. But it would be great to keep me motivated if I could try to make at least a little bit of revenue from these recordings. So if you do find these recordings useful or interesting, then you can donate as much or as little as you want by going to my Patreon page. So basically just go to scienceontheedge.com, all one word, scienceontheedge.com. Click on the donate button, and there are two options there. One is Patreon. You can click on Patreon and donate as little as you want or as much as you want to support this podcast, as little as a couple of dollars, as much as you like. I have no upper limit. Alternatively, on that donate page, there is a PayPal link which lets you just donate a set standard amount of $3 just to keep me motivated. You don't have to donate. But it's up there if you do feel that you would like to support this podcast. Okay, so let's get on. This particular topic is going to be all about supplements and other little tricks that we can perform to sort of help cheat death to a point. So we don't have a fountain of youth just yet, but there are certain techniques which seem to really extend both lifespan and health span. And I'm going to tell you very briefly about some of them. So let's get started with that. First of all, I'm going to talk about a few supplements. So the first supplement is one I've mentioned before, nicotinamide riboside and nicotinamide mononucleotide. Now, I'm going to be very brief explaining how these things work. If you want to know how they work in detail, then I have a podcast all about them. But basically, in all of our cells, we have mitochondria, and we have a process that goes on within the mitochondria that generates ATP, energy, and a process that goes on in the cytoplasm, but also generates energy. Now, a lot of that energy is in the form of ATP, but part of that energy, or at least part of what allows us to use that energy effectively, involves a molecule called NAD. NAD. Now, NAD, NAD is a sort of, it's a coenzyme. It's a coenzyme, which means it helps enzymes in our body, in our cells, to perform their function. We need enzymes to do everything in our cells, really, to build things, to break things apart, to recycle things, to operate pumps, to allow our immune system to be functional. All of these things we require enzymes for. And NAD is a coenzyme, and it's essential for many other enzymes and processes within our cells to function properly. So why do I mention NAD? Because as you get older, NAD levels drop. Once you get past about 40, NAD levels drop substantially, which means we're not able to repair our cells as efficiently, to generate as much energy, to grow, to think, to do anything quite so well. And the older we get, the lower our NAD levels are. Now you might say, he's going to suggest supplementing with NAD. No, I am not. You can supplement with NAD. You can go to a health food store and you can buy NAD supplements. But don't. They are useless. If you have a real deficiency NAD, a massive deficiency, then taking in NAD as supplements might help a little bit. But the problem with NAD supplementation is NAD doesn't really make it into your cells very efficiently. It doesn't really get into your cells. It gets processed by the liver. So what we really need to do is to get something that will allow your cells to build up NAD. And there are supplements that do that. NR, nicotinamide riboside, and NMN, nicotinamide mononucleotide, are both supplements, quite expensive supplements, I should say. But these supplements, they do get taken up by your cells directly. So you can take these supplements. They won't just go to the liver and get processed there. They will make it into your cells. And these two products, NR and NMN, when they get into your cells, they get converted into NAD within your cells. So what you're basically doing when you take these supplements is you're building up a store of NAD within your cells. And that store can be used to power your cells and to allow all those enzymes to perform their functions. Basically, NR and NMN as supplements increase energy levels. A lot of recent studies, these are relatively new supplements, show that they increase alertness, energy levels, the ability, the strength of the immune system, and all sorts of other great things. You need a powerful immune system to function in life. One of the things that causes a lot of problems as we get older is our immune system weakening. Increase NAD levels, you increase the strength of your immune system. So those are my first supplements, NR and NMN. The next one I'm going to talk about is resveratrol. Resveratrol is something you get in grape skins, red grape skins. It's produced by various plants as a kind of stressor. So when plants are exposed to harsh conditions such as drought, they produce resveratrol. Well, certain plants produce resveratrol. And that resveratrol causes these plants, the cells of the plants, to switch on a certain pathway, a certain gene. They upregulate molecules called sirtuins. Sirtuins increase in response to resveratrol, basically. So a stress causes resveratrol levels to increase. Resveratrol levels increase the activity of these sirtuins, these little compounds within the cells. And sirtuins, they protect the cells. They kind of allow the cells to go into a kind of lean burn known as autophagy. Autophagy is when a cell stops just using energy and burning it willy-nilly, so to speak. Instead, what sirtuins do is they cause cells to become more efficient, to start recycling old molecules within the cells, to basically get rid of all the damaged proteins that accumulate in a cell as it gets older, to recycle them, to get rid of old damaged structures known as organelles within the cells, to get rid of the damaged ones, produce shiny new organelles. Basically, the cells become healthier in the presence of sirtuins, and resveratrol in plants stimulates the production and or at least the activity of sirtuins. And what's great is that humans have those same pathways. When we and other mammals take resveratrol, our sirtuin activity increases too. And our cells are more likely to go into autophagy and to become healthier, to recycle damaged components and to become healthier, more efficient structures. Resveratrol you can get as a supplement. Now let's talk about something that you can obtain as a supplement, but it's a little bit more difficult to get, and that is metformin. Now, metformin is a drug that's used to treat type 2 diabetes. It's a drug that's been around since the 1950s. It's a natural compound. It seems, well, without going into too much detail, and as I say, I will and I have done that in longer podcasts, but what metformin basically does is it allows you to process sugar more efficiently. So it regulates insulin levels in the body and it regulates sugar metabolism. Basically, too much insulin, too much sugar in the blood causes inflammation, causes damage to your cells, damage to your body, and reduces health span and lifespan. Now, metformin helps to regulate sugar and insulin. And that's why it's taken by people with type 2 diabetes. Now, metformin off-label can be taken as a means to increase health span and longevity. And many experiments have shown that metformin does exactly that. It increases your health span. In fact, it's estimated that I think it's something like about 40%. I may be wrong with this figure, but something like 40% of executives in Silicon Valley actually take metformin despite not having diabetes. They are that confident in its effects. Okay, the next one. Now, this is a bit more dangerous and a bit more controversial. Rapamycin. Now, this particular compound, what it does, it was originally discovered and used to prevent tissue rejection following organ transplants. It basically dulls down the activity of the immune system in a certain way, so that you don't have an autoimmune reaction to these tissues that you have been donated following a transplantation. But it seems that this particular compound does this by interacting with a receptor known as mTOR. Now, the mTOR receptor, it's a receptor that your cells possess. When it is basically inhibited by this rapamycin, then what occurs is a number of different genetic pathways are regulated. They get manipulated by interference of the mTOR receptor. The end result is inflammation goes down, growth is inhibited. You don't want cells to grow out of control because that can lead to cancer. You want growth and division to be regulated. And by inhibiting mTOR, you regulate it more efficiently. The cells, once again, go into a sort of lean burn. They don't process sugar and energy quite the same way your cells in the presence of this compound. And it seems in a number of experiments that when you actually take rapamycin, you can help to improve your lifespan and health span, although evidence is still being accumulated, experiments are still being done regarding this. Okay, so that's some supplements. Just some brief supplements that I thought I would mention. Next, I'm going to talk very briefly about exercise. I know this is an old one, but it's still the most effective way to increase health and longevity. When you exercise, if you exercise properly, you don't overdo it, you don't overstrain yourself, you do it correctly. When you exercise, you basically cause damage to your tissues, but it's a very sudden damage, and the repair from that damage actually brings down inflammation and increases certain growth factors in the muscles, which makes the muscles denser and stronger, and the bones too, but also increases the levels of certain neurotrophic growth factors in the brain. So the brain actually benefits from exercise. Neurons start to make more connections following exercise. So exercise is good for both the body and the brain. If you don't want to exercise, there is an alternative, and that is taking a sauna. Saunas are incredibly beneficial. A number of experts in Finland and other places have, I say Finland, you might wonder why Finland. Well, because I used to actually work in Finland, and in Finland, pretty much every home and every office has a sauna. Sauna use is huge, so it seemed like the ideal place to actually research the benefits of sauna. And it turns out that regular sauna use, it brings down inflammation, it increases cardiovascular health, it increases health span, it reduces the risks of certain diseases such as Alzheimer's. It's very good for the body and for the brain. There's a number of theories as to why, which I do go into more detail about in longer form podcasts. But basically that the shock to the body of heat in the form of a sauna causes your cells to produce things called heat shock proteins. And these heat shock proteins, they kind of protect the infrastructure of your cells. Imagine they're putting a scaffolding around all the delicate structures within your cells. So a short sauna, maybe just 20 minutes, half an hour, causes the levels of these heat shock proteins to increase, but they stay high for up to 48 hours. So you come out of the sauna, there's no more heat, but the heat shock proteins are still there protecting your cells. So regular sauna use has huge benefits. Next, cold showers and baths. Very unpleasant cold showers and baths, but quite good for you, quite good for you. Basically, within your body, you have a type of cell known as an adipose cell. Adipose cells are where we store our fat. And there are brown adipose cells and white adipose cells. The white adipose cells just kind of store fat and sit there. They don't do much good. The brown adipose cells, they don't just store the fat, they actually burn some of it up and generate heat. Babies pretty much just have the brown adipose tissue. As you get older, you lose brown adipose tissue and you increase the amount of white adipose tissue, which is why as you get older, it tends to be easier to put on weight because you're not burning as much of the fat as energy. Where do cold showers and baths come into play? Well, it seems that if you take regular cold baths, cold showers, that shock of the cold causes some of your white adipose tissue to actually convert into brown adipose tissue. And brown adipose tissue then burns the fat that's present to generate heat. So you can lose weight by having cold showers and baths. And if you can lose fat, then you can decrease the likelihood of developing cardiovascular disease, stroke, those sorts of things. Okay, now the final section of this short podcast, this Science on the Edge bite size, is about diet. So specifically fasting. Now, fasting has over recent years been shown to be extremely beneficial if done correctly. Starving yourself isn't good for you. You need nutrients, you need energy to live, to survive, to grow and repair your body. But short bursts of fasting, so for example, 3 days on a water-only diet, for example. By the way, don't enter a diet like that unless you know that you are physically capable of tolerating it. If you have underlying health issues, you might want to consult a doctor first. But 3 days of just water, no food at all, what will happen is your body will first of all use all of its glycogen stores, sugar stores, which are stored in the liver and muscle. They will run out very quickly. You can only store about 2,000 or 3,000 calories of sugar within your body. And when your body runs out of sugar, it has to switch to burning fat instead. It has to go into something called ketosis and generate ketone bodies from the fat. When your body goes into ketosis, lots of genes are switched on or regulated in a very interesting way. The short story of the result of this regulation, this change in regulation in the keto, in when you enter ketosis, is that you basically reduce inflammation, you burn up a lot of fat, particularly fat around your visceral tissue, meaning the fat that's around your heart and organs, that's the damaging fat. You start burning that up. You produce less insulin, and insulin causes inflammation. You only need insulin to regulate sugar. And if you have no sugar in your body, then insulin levels drop, so inflammation goes down. So long story short, fasting, done occasionally for about 3 days, is extremely good for you. One of the benefits of fasting is it kills off senescent cells. Senescent cells are old damaged cells that just sit around in your organs, releasing inflammatory chemicals that damage you. They accumulate as you get older, these senescent cells. They don't do what they're supposed to do. They release damaging chemicals that cause damage to your body. They stimulate your immune system and cause it to become overactive. But fasting destroys these senescent cells. So very useful. Do a bit of research before you engage in any sort of fasting diet. It should only be done occasionally, but for at least about 3 days to get any benefits. Okay, so this has been a very short bite-sized episode. I hope you've learned something. If you want to know more information about any of the supplements I've talked about, or about the forms of exercise, or about fasting, just check through my back catalogue of Science on the Edge podcasts, where I go into these topics in a lot more detail. Okay, so thank you very much for listening, and I hope to speak to you all again very soon. Have a great day. Goodbye.